Thank you all for coming to this session of the Congressional Briefings offered by the National History Center. My name is Dane Kennedy. I'm director of the National History Center. Just briefly, I want to note that this is an initiative of the American Historical Association, and this particular program is one that's funded by the Mellon Foundation. The National History Center is a nonprofit, and these programs are strictly our aim in these programs is to sort of bring a historical perspective to contemporary policy issues that Congress is addressing or may be addressing. And we're delighted today to have the panel here on drug addiction and drug policy. Alan Kraut, professor of history from American University, will moderate the session and introduce the speakers. So I'll turn it over to Alan.
Thank you, Dan.
Good morning. We're a society that's really obsessed with celebrity. What happens to celebrities in politics and sports and theater attracts our attention, perhaps even fascination. And this includes what makes them ill and sometimes even what kills them, whether it's the link between Yankee baseball great Lou Gehrig and ALS, or Magic Johnson and HIV/AIDS. Celebrity patients often serve to attract attention, research, funding, and policy making when it comes to health challenges. And so it's been since the death of Prince several weeks ago from what may have been an overdose of pain-killing drugs. Debates over American drug policy are hardly new, and drug addiction epidemics have long been on the national radar. The number of overdose deaths from legal opioid drugs surged by 16.3% in 2014 to 18,893, while overdose fatalities from heroin climbed by 28% to 10,574. The concern about opioids and the term opioid epidemic has amplified demand in some quarters for congressional action. Those concerned with one particular opioid, heroin, want to discuss legalization and decriminalization. Others want to focus great attention on prescription medications and advocate greater control and regulation. All those engaged in this ongoing debate, especially policymakers, would do well to consult the past for some context and perhaps even guidance. Everything has a history, and that history matters. As recently as last Saturday, the New York Times carried an op-ed piece by former FDA Commissioner David Kessler that called for a look to the past to learn how the opioid epidemic may have begun. He writes, quote, beginning in the late 1990s, pharmaceutical companies selling high-dose opioids seized upon, based on flimsy scientific evidence, that regardless of the length of treatment, patients would not become addicted to opioids. It has proven to be one of the biggest mistakes in modern medicine, end quote. Whether or not Kessler is correct, history's light needs to be shined on the history of opioid addiction and epidemics. And that is the reason that the National History Center has organized this congressional briefing and invited two of our country's really outstanding historians of medicine and public health to share their expertise. Our first presenter this morning, a founding member of the National History Center, will offer us an overview of the history of U.S. drug policy. Dr. David T. Courtwright is presidential professor at the University of North Florida. He earned his Ph.D. at Rice University and is the author of many important volumes on drug use, drug politics, and drug policy. And these include Force of Habit, Drugs in the Making of the Modern World, 2001, Dark Paradise, A History of Opiate Addiction in America, revised edition, 2001, No Right Turn, Conservative Politics in Liberal America, 2010, and Addicts Who Survive, 2012. With the assistance of the National Endowment for the Humanities Public Scholar Grant, Dr. Courtwright is currently writing a global history, very ambitious, global history of pleasure, vice, and addiction. He is also the past president of the Alcohol and Drugs History Society. Our second presenter this morning will offer us an historical perspective on some economic trends that affect the current crisis in opioid and painkiller use, is an MD PhD. Dr. Keith Wailoo is Townsend Martin Professor of History and Public Affairs at Princeton University, where he holds a joint appointment in the Department of History and the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs. An elected member of the National Academy of Medicine, Dr. Wailoo is the author of many important volumes in the history of medicine that grace the shelves of me and my colleagues. On that shelf, I read this morning, was Pain, A Political History, published in 2014. And that was preceded by How Cancer Crossed the Color Line, in 2011. Before that, Dying in the City of Blues, Sickle Cell Anemia, and the Politics of Race and Health, in 2001. He's also the co-editor of Medicare and Medicaid at 50, America's Entitlement Programs in the Age of Affordable Care, 2015. And Three Shots at Prevention, the HPV Vaccine and the Politics of Medicine's Simple Solutions, in 2010. His research has been supported by grants and fellowships from many prestigious sources, including the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, the National Institutes of Health, the National Science Foundation, and the James S. McDonald Foundation. In addition to his scholarly publications, he is a frequent contributor to the New York Times, American Prospect, The Lancet, and so on. So it's with great pleasure that I introduce two dear colleagues and friends this morning, Drs. Courtwright and Wailoo. David?
Good morning. In trying to frame this briefing, I thought, what's a good opening sentence? And I decided that the best one was, the one constant in American drug policy history is that people are constantly trying to change it. And so what I thought I would do today is give you a jet airplane trip over the history of those changes. And here you see basically four main reform traditions, all right, with representative goals and tactics. And then notice that I've divided each of these into a soft and a hard camp. And movements basically followed one another in this order, and whenever the hard policy advocates triumphed, they invariably provoked reactions, and that's why you see a kind of cyclical pattern. And I suspect the cycle will continue, even as the drug war appears to be winding down. So the first tradition, progressivism, created the modern system of drug regulation and selective prohibition. Progressive drug reform was part of a larger wave of global anti-vice activism, which aimed at social evils like drunkenness and prostitution and pornography. And the campaign against commercialized vice bore fruit during the progressive era, which was also when the first national drug laws were enacted. Now, all progressives agreed that drugs should be decommodified, but they didn't agree on the means to accomplish that, whether through regulation or prohibition of non-medical use. They also didn't necessarily agree on which psychoactive substances should be prohibited. So this is Charles Henry Brent. He epitomized the tradition I call soft progressivism between 1909 and 1912. He chaired the opium conferences that laid the foundations for the international treaty system to limit narcotic production to estimated medical needs. But Brent, a liberal Episcopalian, differed with Dries, who wanted to ban non-medical alcohol use in the United States. And in fact, he said in Brent that he thought that the prohibition of the Bulletin Act was a mistake. Most Americans thought like Brent. What happened was basically an unusual combination of circumstances. The Great War, resurgent nativism, new revenue from the income tax, gross malapportionment, and highly creative single-issue politics enabled hard progressives to secure passage of the 18th Amendment to the Constitution. The same year, 1919, they also got the Volstead Act and a favorable ruling by the United States Supreme Court that upheld the Treasury Department's position on maintenance, namely, there would be no maintenance of non-medical addicts. And then between 1895 and 1927, it may interest you to know that the hard progressives also managed to persuade no fewer than 15 state legislatures to ban the sale of cigarettes, which is a sort of forgotten prohibition in American history. And then in 1924, Congress outlawed the manufacture of heroin. And yet, cracks soon began appearing in hard progressivism's facade. After repeal in 1933, the number of Americans living in dry districts plummeted. Cigarette manufacturers overcame all legal and social obstacles to turn their product into the great modern pacifier, and new habit-forming sedatives and stimulants caught on in both medical and non-medical circles. Meanwhile, the Bureau of Narcotics maintained tight control over opiates and cocaine. State laws, and in 1937, federal legislation made marijuana an illicit drug. Bureau of Narcotics head Harry Anslinger epitomized the hard line against both narcotics and marijuana. He strove to limit narcotic production, minimize diversion, interdict trafficking, suppress non-medical use, isolate addicts, and of course forbid maintenance. He also lobbied for mandatory minimum sentences, which Congress enacted in 1951 and again in 1956, and many state legislatures followed suit. Now this mid-century regime, basically the under-regulation of some drugs, the demonization of other drugs, struck liberal critics as indefensible. They wanted to both rationalize and medicalize policy. They believed that drug use did not always produce aberrant behavior, and they believed that it did not always lead to addiction. Perfectly correct view. When it did, addicts should be treated and rehabilitated, not forced into the black market. Expensive drugs cause them to commit crimes. Adulterated drugs cause them to drop dead. Hence, many liberals became interested in narcotic maintenance experiments. Psychiatrist Lawrence Kahl was the paladin of soft liberalism. Kahl was America's leading addiction researcher in the 1920s and 1930s. He was the first medical superintendent of the Lexington Narcotics Hospital, and he thought addiction was a mental disease whose victims ought to be supervised rather than repressed. Those are his words. He denounced long sentences for narcotics and cannabis users. And in 1962, he issued a durable manifesto, and I quote, "This country suffers less from the disease than from the misguided frenzy of suppressing it." What separated hard liberals from soft was the issue of maintenance, particularly indefinite maintenance. Vincent Dole and Marie Niswander pioneered methadone maintenance, which expanded rapidly during the heroin epidemic of the late 1960s and early 1970s. Doctors Dole and Niswander questioned whether treatment should necessarily aim at abstinence. They believed that indefinite high-dose maintenance was the most realistic goal for many of their heroin-addicted patients. Health and behavior were what mattered, not the presence or absence of opiates. Hard liberals also tended to support marijuana decriminalization and more rational regulation of other drugs, including sedatives, stimulants, alcohol, and tobacco. Thus, the early 1970s was a time of ferment in drug policy and treatment, a moment when the old paradigm of double-standard progressivism seemed to be giving way to a new and more rational paradigm of public health liberalism. Then politics got in the way, which is interestingly why most people recall the early 70s as a period of both creativity, a kind of golden age of medicalization, and also the beginning of the drug war. And they're not wrong to do so. That's a perfectly reasonable way to describe the era. Why did this happen? Well, Richard Nixon was a protean politician who stitched together policies from disparate elements that suited his immediate political purposes. His eclecticism was on full display in his drug policy, taken from, I would argue, all three drug policy reform traditions. So, for most drugs, Nixon favored expert schedule determining and prescription regulations. In other words, soft progressivism. Liberals, hard and soft, supported portions of the 1970 Controlled Substances Act, which systematized drug scheduling, provided new money for public health approaches in Title I, and eliminated both mandatory and minimum sentences, including those for cannabis possession, which is something a lot of people forget about the 1970 legislation. Nixon launched SEADAP and NIDA and gave them unprecedented resources for treatment and research, and he listened to his advisors and he backed methadone. Yet Nixon also had a streak of hard progressivism. He regarded illicit drug use by young people as social rot. Earlier in his career, he had called for the execution of drug traffickers with multiple convictions. That was during his 1962 gubernatorial campaign. And in 1971, he officially launched his own drug war. Phase one featured rhetoric and photo ops, including Elvis's iconic visit to the White House to pick out a BND badge, now playing at a movie theater in New York. In 1972, Nixon's drug war took a harder turn with the rejection of the Liberal Schaefer Commission report on marijuana and the creation of the Office of Drug Abuse Law Enforcement, ODIL. We also know from the White House tapes that Nixon envied New York Governor Nelson Rockefeller's draconian new drug laws. And in fact, in March of 1973, Nixon himself proposed mandatory minimum sentences of 5 years for convicted marijuana traffickers and life without parole for those who had prior drug felonies. Well, Nixon's gambit to essentially nationalize the Rockefeller laws got lost in the Watergate crisis of 1973-1974. Legislation went nowhere, but the drug war toward which Nixon was veering sprang back to life in the late 1970s and the early 1980s. The national group was changing, the right activists were accusing liberals of fostering dependency and permissiveness, cocaine was more fashionable than ever, and by 1979, two-thirds of high school seniors in this country admitted using an illicit drug, most often marijuana. The parents groups that began forming in 1977 wanted zero tolerance, marijuana would be stigmatized, more law enforcement, more youth prevention programs, and authoritarian treatment that was geared toward abstinence epitomized by the therapeutic communities. First Lady Nancy Reagan became the public face of this movement during the early moralizing phase of the 1980s drug war, but it was President George H.W. Bush who provided the signature moment of the drug war's hard phase. When on September 5th, 1989, he displayed a bag of crack to a national television audience, a bag that had allegedly been seized near the White House, Congress had already passed two anti-drug bills that were larger and more punitive than anything that had been passed in the 1950s. But Bush wanted more legislation. So did then-Senator Joe Biden, who delivered the televised response to the president's speech, in which Senator Biden said, and I quote, "President Bush's policy was not tough enough." Those were his exact words. Drug policy had become a partisan bidding game, which was essentially why President Bill Clinton had so little room to maneuver during his administration of 1993 to 2001. Even so, sentiment and the drug war developed momentum through the 1990s. Mass incarceration had decimated minority communities, yet produced no decline in the purity or the availability of drugs. What Culp had said in 1962 about the cure being worse than the disease still applied in 1992. In fact, it applied even more forcefully because HIV/AIDS had raised the stakes. AIDS researchers like Dante Marlay advocated programs to provide sterile needles and syringes. Like the liberals, harm reductionists wanted addicts in treatment rather than in prison. Treatment included medically assisted recovery with methadone, or after 2002, buprenorphine. Most harm reductionists also favored medical marijuana, which they thought could alleviate the symptoms of AIDS and other chronic diseases.
harm reduction is now clearly in the ascendancy. 24 states and the District of Columbia allow medical marijuana. More if you count high THC, low CBD cannabis states like my own state of Florida. Crack sentencing has been amended. Both parties are interested in clemency opportunities for nonviolent drug offenders. So is President Obama, who has recently embraced harm reduction along with the recovering opioid addict. This is a straightforward proposition, the president said this March in Atlanta. How do we save lives? But there are drug war opponents who want more, including recreational purchase of cannabis by adults, so far enacted by four states, heroin maintenance clinics, and an end to Schedule I type prohibitions. And in fact, at its limit, the hard position becomes libertarianism, a la Milton Friedman, who was not coincidentally one of the earliest and most consistent critics of the drug war going all the way back to the 1960s. Given the waning of the culture war that framed the drug war, and given the ongoing secular and submissive drift of American culture, especially among the young, it seems likely that at least some states will venture further down the legalization path. Prominent journalists have urged just such a course, legalize it all. But a good title is not necessarily a good policy. If and where harm reductionism evolves into full-blown drug libertarianism, it will produce another reaction. Diversion and youthful experimentation will remain sensitive issues, as will commercialization and addiction. Now, I say this with a great deal of confidence because it's already happening with opioids. Two decades of liberalized prescribing for chronic pain have led to a crisis of opioid addictions, and currently around 28,000 deaths a year from overdose. And something else President Obama mentioned in Atlanta. The result has been state regulatory crackdowns, stricter CDC prescribing guidelines, and the rise of neo-progressive advocacy groups like PROC, which stands for Physicians for Responsible Opioid Prescribing. The cannabis equivalent is SAM, S-A-M, which stands for Smart Approaches to Marijuana. SAM's message, beware commercialized marijuana. The Quisberg could also assume a Bloombergian form. It's the most complicated word you're going to hear this morning. With renewed determination to stop people from making unhealthful choices whose costs we all bear. Given what we now know about the common neural pathways of substance and behavioral addictions, it seems likely that the neo-progressives will turn their attention to more than simply drugs. Their targets could also include hyper-palatable foods, gambling machines, addictive digital devices, and hot gases in the lungs of all psychoactive varieties. As if on cue, last week, the FDA announced stricter regulations for e-cigarettes and cigars. So, the basic historical problem, namely that commercial interests can hook us with products that are bad for us, has not gone away. In fact, it's gotten much worse. Therefore, it's hard to imagine a future in which the regulatory impulse will simply go away. It is possible to imagine a future in which we do not let the regulatory impulse run away. But that will require reining in two of the forces, political advantage and ideological messianism, that have destabilized drug policy for more than a century. So to conclude, you can find the sources for all of the pre-Obama quotes and statistics in these three books. And I will be happy to take your answers later, or take your questions rather, during the Q&A later. And I now yield to my colleague, Keith Whitley.
Uh, Thank you, David, and thanks, Alan, for the introduction. I should say one thing. Alan, yeah, was very gracious in granting me a medical degree as well as a Ph.D., which I did not earn. I just was an M.D. I taught in medical school for many years, but they never saw fit to actually grant me a degree. So my comments are going to be easy to reduce to sort of 3 points. One of the things David highlights is the problem of illicit drugs that become problem drugs. There's another phenomenon that we're dealing with today simultaneously, which is the phenomenon of illicit drugs that become problem drugs. That is to say, migrating from the market, the regulated market, into the through drug diversion. And I'll be spending more of my time talking about this second phenomenon. And I thought instead of coming to the problem of drug problems from the standpoint of the history of drugs, I come to it from the background of studying pain. That is to say, how did pain become a problem, and how does pain become a drug problem? I'm going to take an economic approach that really focuses on the last stage of the book that I wrote. It's called, the chapter is called OxyContin Unleashed. And there are really 3 points I want to highlight, which is that drug problems, drug epidemics, don't have one cause. And I want to focus on three of them. Over the last four decades, from 1976 roughly to 2016, there are three economic trends that have created a convergence of forces leading towards the current epidemic in heroin and prescription drug painkiller abuse. And these economic trends are, one, the challenges in regulating these drugs that spur a kind of cycle, a recurrent cycle of booms and busts in the painkiller drug market. So OxyContin is just the latest in a phenomenon where the drug that emerges to solve a pressing problem in chronic pain becomes a problem in itself. I want to illustrate that very briefly. The second thing the economic force I want to look at is the continuing economic decline of the rural sector, which has meant lost jobs, high stress, and an unprecedented rural drug crisis, symbolized not just by heroin and oxycodone, but also methamphetamines. And the third economic crisis, the challenge that has really driven this, is something that we don't usually talk about, which is the health insurance reimbursement system, which has led to the decline of a model that used to be fairly prominent in pain care, which is the integrated, multidisciplinary pain center that proposed multiple, not just pharmacological, but other approaches to dealing with the increasing problem of chronic pain. Where did that model go? Well, it largely went away because it's costly, and in an era of cost containment, our emphasis has been towards pharmacological quick fixes. And in that context, that's another economic trend that shapes this contemporary problem. So I want to highlight, and I could stop right there, but I want to illustrate each of those, which is that this confluence of three economic forces lead towards and lay the groundwork for the current epidemic that we're seeing in heroin, opioids, and prescription drug painkillers. Let me go through each of them. First, the boom and the bust cycle. As I describe in this book, Pain, the Political History, especially in the last chapter, OxyContin Unleashed, scientists and industry have long sought the magic painkiller that would replace morphine. Always looking for the last 100 years for the drug that will do the seemingly miraculous, that is, treat pain and treat it in a sustained and regular fashion without fostering dependence and addiction. And every 6 or 7 years, we find it. And then 6 or 7 years later, we realize we haven't found it. And this has been recurring. This happened before OxyContin in the 1990s. OxyContin in the 1990s is merely the latest in the cycle of these promising drugs that create booms, market successes. Some of them last. So Motrin, ibuprofen, is one that lasts. In some ways, that was the model in the 1970s. Everyone wanted to produce a similar kind of painkiller. But many of them have really not lived up to their promise, and have created public health controversies as well as pharmacological controversies in their wake. The boom and the bust cycle goes back to the 1950s with Demerol, Perpidan, which, by the way, is oxycodone. That is to say, OxyContin returns again much later in a new form. which also drew the attention in the 1960s of legislatures and Congress because precisely of this tension between is the drug delivering on the promise of pain relief without fostering addiction. After Percodan and Demerol, there was Eli Lilly's Oriflex in the 1980s, the early 1980s, which, as one business reporter noted, set the company on some wild rides up and down. Sales rising, but then linked to multiple deaths due to liver and kidney failures, and pulled from the market. And then after Oriflex, there was Toradol by the Syntex Corporation in the late 1980s and early 1990s, touted as a revolutionary painkiller, which 3 years later was also pulled from the market, linked to kidney failure and gastrointestinal bleeding. So most of the side effects, really, in the 80s and 90s were pharmacological, were bodily failure, were side effects that related to health, not the social side effects that we're discussing today. And then, of course, there was the memorable Merck Vioxx case, the COX-2 inhibitor, along with Celebrex, which invited a similar kind of set of controversies. Merck's drug also pulled from the market, although Celebrex still on the market, in which it becomes clear that physicians in prescribing have to weigh the long-term health risks, heart problems, with the short-term gains associated with arthritis relief, right? This is the space in which painkillers have existed from really 1950s until the present. And it's really in this context that OxyContin, Purdue Pharma's OxyContin, emerges in the 1990s. It's oxycodone back again. And OxyContin promised that Percodan didn't was this magical time release quality. That instead of sort of delivering the full dose all the way, it would provide a time release in such a way that addiction and dependence would not result. Well, anybody who watches the history of these drug epidemics knows that it's bound to turn out poorly. And surely, one of the things people didn't understand is that you could crush the pill, and actually it would deliver the same relief that Percodan did. So, but in the early 2000s, we're talking about $1.5 billion in revenues for Purdue Pharma. If you study the history of these booms and busts, you see that it's bound to turn out badly, and in fact, even in the early 2000s, it was clear that there were unintended side effects. Now, one of the features of this boom and bust is that it puts the FDA in a very complicated bind, which is both a kind of a drug approval bind, but it's also a political bind. On the one hand, you're constantly being pressed to approve drugs more quickly in the name of innovation and in the name of speedy patient care. But then you're often reacting once the promise turns into a peril, after the horse has left the barn. So since the 1980s, as a result of a greater emphasis on speedy drug approvals, and this is also a story of kind of deregulation in American government more generally, the trend has been the increase of information to consumers, direct-to-consumer advertising, putting information in the hands of consumers, bringing drugs out more quickly to solve the problems that ail us, and then in some ways reacting to the unintended but not altogether unexpected consequences that emerge when a drug becomes part of the market. It's a system that you might say that promotes consumption and consumerism, which will inevitably produce market successes, but also periodic crises. And the OxyContin crisis was just one of many. It had many historical precursors. The problem I want to highlight is therefore not just prescribing behavior and illegitimate patients. There is, of course, a high and legitimate demand for painkillers in this time period, increasing rates of chronic illness, chronic pain, end-of-life pain. According to an IOM report, there's 50-plus million Americans who have some degree of chronic pain, and the number rises as the population grows more aged. So I'm not saying that this is an illegitimate problem at all. It's just that we create sort of market solutions to these problems, and then we deal with the unintended consequences. That seems to be one of the ways that we manage drugs in our society. At the same time, we have a problem in the US because at a certain point during this early 1990s period, we were the consumer of something like 90% of all of the oxycodone being consumed in the world, which is not to say that we have 90% of the pain in the world. right? There is clearly a mismatch, right, between the nature of the problem and the way we solve these problems. With every boom and bust, the answer has often been, well, how do we find a better pill that doesn't create the problems that the last one created? Continuing this cycle of putting the public at risk, solving problems, but creating new ones, with very little attention to the lessons learned. In the US, the response to this cycle has been a combination of approaches. Post-market surveillance, doing a better job of spotting problem drugs when they're on the market earlier. Legal actions by patients against companies for not appropriately disclosing the known dangers of dependency or the risks of death. That's another way we solve these problems in our society, in a litigious society. Or legal action or settlements brought by state governments or federal governments for illegal practices of like promoting off-label uses of these drugs. So you have a wide range of settlements in the 1990s and 2000s against some of these companies, which are really small, you know, they're very small penalties to pay when you consider the overall revenues. And then we also have laws that are passed in states like Connecticut and others against what are called doctor shopping, to try to regulate the way in which patients move from practitioner to practitioner to build up storehouses of these substances. These are all really modest sort of piecemeal efforts after the horse has left the barn, right? That's how we tend to regulate this boom and bust cycle. A second issue is that you might say this economic pattern of the way drugs arrive to market has met an economic problem in rural America that has been growing and developing over the last three decades, where people suffer economically, whether it's because of poverty, loss of factory jobs, in cities, or in rural economic decline, drugs have often filled a void in the wake of the loss of labor, or to relieve pain caused by heavy and excruciating work. So it's no surprise that when OxyContin first appeared as a drug problem, it appeared in places like Appalachia, 2001. You'd find an article like this in the Cincinnati Inquirer. OxyContin abuse said likely to spread, Appalachian economy tied to painkiller abuse. The story emphasized the decline of the mining industry, rural economic depression, and the rural epidemic, which is also linked to methamphetamine. Right? So this is 16 years ago. If you read the newspaper 16 years ago, nothing that we're seeing today is surprising. In fact, in the early 1990s, when you looked at the main areas where OxyContin prescriptions were, it was the four leading states, West Virginia, Alaska, Florida, and Maine, right? Overlaps very, very closely with what we're seeing today with heroin as well. This is a general truth about drugs and alcohol and economic history. Economic decline, whether urban, rural, suburban, jobs, hardships, loneliness, desperation, socioeconomic challenges really create opportunities for these drugs. And of course, as I said, the market provided many different kinds of solutions in quotes. This is true of the economics of drugs, the way in which drugs find their way into areas of economic decline. It's true of morphine. David Courtwright has written about this with the early days in the 1920s of cocaine. This is true of methamphetamine, certainly. It's true of heroin and OxyContin today. Of course, economic decline is not the only reason. Other drug epidemics like the Milltown Valium tranquilizer epidemic was more common in sort of suburban America in the 1950s. Rave drugs and drugs that are, you know, and stimulants used on college campuses have different origins. So this is only one of the factors that shape, the economic factors that shape why different populations turn to drugs in this kind of form. But it is one of the truths is that the historically drug epidemics like this one are seen as fueled by economic decline, and that addressing the economic challenges confronting these communities is crucial in the long run for addressing the drug problem. Finally, I'd like to say a little word about the third economic factor that we pay very little attention to, which is a trend in insurance reimbursement for chronic pain relief, which has reinforced the value of pharmaceutical approaches over other integrated, multidisciplinary approaches. The period from 1960 to 1975, during which pain was being recognized as a legitimate problem, chronic pain in medicine, in this era, what you saw was a multitude of different approaches, not just pharmacological, in thinking about how to relieve and address the problem of pain. You had the rise of something called multidisciplinary pain centers in academic centers, where you have surgeons, psychologists, psychiatrists, as well as pharmacologists and anesthesiologists, sort of thinking through tough problems in pain care. This is an era that produced a lot of alternatives. Non-opioid innovations in pain care, the electrical nerve stimulation, the TENS units that we often wear for low back pain, emerge out of this time period. Acupuncture, alternative approaches. One of the founders of pain, pain as a sort of a subjective problem, and the psychologist named Ronald Melzack noted that relaxants, tranquilizers, sedatives, suggestion, placebo, hypnosis are all known to influence pain and all deserve attention more than they receive. Now, what happened in the 1980s, you won't be surprised, is the trend towards cost containment. After all of this is very expensive. Multidisciplinary pain care costs a lot of money, not easily reimbursed. What's more easy to reimburse? Well, a drug for a problem. So people who familiar with pain care in the 1960s and 1970s say, what happened to the integrated pain center? And it largely was the victim of the economic trends we see in healthcare more generally. That is to say, the urge towards health maintenance organizations, cost containment, and this leads towards the more simple approaches, drugs as quick fixes. So investments in integrated pain management did not really happen after the 1980s. And increasingly, the drugs also filled that void, OxyContin, et cetera. In some ways, this is how our society is organized. Not only do we approve drugs and deal with the problem after the horse has left the barn, but we have, economically, you might say, we have two major trends. We have a trend towards more consumption, and we have a trend towards less consumption, as in the form of insurance that tries to limit overconsumption. And these do battle in American medical market, right? And this is how we deal with this is the place I suspect that drugs, the space that drugs fill in our economic system. And people in pain are often the victims. So you'll see people complaining about lack of access to pain medicine because their insurance company won't pay. But you'll also see people sort of pushing the FDA and others for faster approval, right? We are kind of caught in the system. Now, chronic pain is costly, it's frustrating, and we need to find ways to support more costly and effective alternatives besides this. Besides the drugs that often produce downstream addiction, overdose, etc. So to summarize, over the past 3 or 4 decades, as I said, this is only one kind of picture of the history, we have these three economic trends. We have the boom and bust cycle in the pain market that puts drugs on the market, and then we deal with the consequences if they emerge. We have the problem of rural economic decline that creates a pool, a need, for these drugs that turn into problems, but often they're prescribed for people who work in mines, who have severe lower back problems, who over the course of time really grow dependent on those drugs and need to be, and they become part of this image that we have of the drug problem in rural America. And then we have a system that really encourages drugs as the primary and first way of relieving pain, chronic pain. And all of these, I suspect, come together. Now, the last thing I'll say is that, as I mentioned, this was not unforeseen. In 2000 and 1999, we see versions of this problem that we see today in rural opioid epidemics. It's just become worse over the last 15 years or so. But I want to suggest that there are moments when policymakers actually identify this as a problem and begin the work of crafting solutions. So back in 2003, there was a bipartisan bill sponsored by Congressional Representative Rogers from Michigan and Lois Capps, so Republican and Democrat, and by Senator Hatch and then Senator Dodd, to try to address the problem of pain in America. Now, it went through the House well, but I think it fell maybe 3 or 4 votes short in the Senate, and it was aimed at educating physicians about the pain problem, how to properly prescribe, but I think more significantly, pain awareness campaigns. And this is back again. In other words, one of the failures of our system is the failure to properly educate physicians as well as people who are looking for relief about the dangers of these prescription drugs, the dangers of solving these problems in the ways that we tend to in American society. So I'm going to end, I think I've gone over my time, but I just sort of hope to illustrate that, you know, the origins of these problems are not single causal. There's sometimes multiple causes that lead us in this direction, and that we've been here before, and we can look back to the past to sort of solutions to how we might proceed in the future. Thanks.
Okay, it's your turn. Go ahead.
Two very interesting presentations. I'd like to ask about the direction of the causality that Dr. Walter just suggested. We had an interesting incident that's already ancient history now. It's happened probably 3 months ago. When Donald Trump was running for president, and he was meeting some opposition from other people in the Republican Party. And the allegation was made that, you know, Trump's supporters are people who are economically unhappy, they can't get good jobs, and the reason they can't get good jobs is because they can't pass a drug test. Yeah. So it's all of these poor blue-collar former workers who are doing badly because they take painkillers. And the implication behind that is that it's not really the economic decline that's causing the addiction to painkillers, but rather the painkillers that are probably contributing significantly to the economic decline. Can you address that?
I'm not going to speak to Trump in particular. but I would say that there's a tension in how we think about drugs, which is to say whether the people are responsible and the people should be blamed, or to what extent an economic system in the aggregate should be held accountable. And what you just laid out is a question to me, which is it the case that blue-collar, you know, workers in the rural South are basically drug addicts, or have they turned to drugs out of desperation, perhaps out of legitimate pain? Now, I don't have the answer to this because I do think that it depends on the particular individual cases. But if you go back 16 years to Cincinnati, it's pretty clear that in Appalachia, the question was about economic depression, but it was also about mining. It's about the nature of hard work in mines, low back pain that results, and those two factors that lead people to legitimately seek relief for pain care. In 2001, OxyContin was seen as a legitimate and desirable innovation in pain medicine that should not produce long-term problems in dependence of the kind that you're describing. So I guess what I'd say is that the people I think about in Appalachia are not victims of economic decline only, nor are they drug, you know, users, but they're also victims of a promise that was made about the nature of pharmacological relief that has not come to pass. And now, to blame them as drug addicts is really, I think, worse than unfortunate, right? Because if you are I'll give you an example, which is a colleague of mine was, her mom died about 2 or 3 months ago in South Carolina, and she was heavily dependent on OxyContin. And because of the anxiety about OxyContin abuse, this is a woman who was dying in her 80s. Her caregivers insisted on not providing her with OxyContin. So she was not only dying, but she was going through drug withdrawal at the same time, right? To me, there's a problem there, where if you decide that all OxyContin users who are illegitimate are drug users, and then you create problems on top of problems. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but I basically said that, you know, it's a false choice whether it's sort of economic, you know, loss or drug abuse. There's an underlying logic that has created it that we need. to fix.
I think that's true, but one thing I would point out in the historical context, one thing that's changed is that we now have close to universal drug screening for people who are seeking employment, which we didn't have, say, in the 1970s. And so once people are locked out of the system for whatever the causality, it's perhaps not as easy to change it as it once was.
Mm-hmm. Sort of two-part question, but the same theme. We're talking about the drug problem in Appalachia and places like that. Are we finding that the people that are addicted to the opioids are the people that were prescribed them themselves, or addicted to the painkillers? Are they the people that are prescribed them themselves, or are they the wider community because it's so broadly prescribed that the person passes away and they get distributed or they steal them from their parents or grandparents? Who's addicted? Who has the higher percentage of addiction? People actually prescribed versus people in the community. And the second part of the question is, if we're talking about the people that were addicted in this area because of the work that they do, they've done this type of work for generations now. Did they have these type of addiction problems back in the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, or drug use issues, or is this more of a more modern problem?
Could I ask you to handle the eating of those, and then I'll come back?
Sure. Yes, in the early 20th century in southern United States, there was a type of narcotic addict who was basically an alcoholic who had started using morphine to sober up from alcoholic sprees. And some of these people turned up at the Lexington Narcotic Hospital when it opened in 1935. But having said that, there was nothing remotely comparable to the current epidemic of opioid addiction in the rural South or Appalachia that we're experiencing today. However, it's also important to understand that even though that epidemic is real and it has affected impoverished rural areas, there are a lot of people who get into trouble with these drugs who don't fit that stereotype. You know, let's not forget the 68-year-old white woman who has lower back pain or bad hips and she starts taking OxyContin or some comparable drug, and she forgets that she took her pill in the morning, she takes another one, and she's dead, all right? Or the 18-year-old high school football player who tears up his knee and goes and receives pain medication, likes it, continues to use it, can no longer afford it, then turns to the burgeoning heroin market. So there are multiple streams. I mean, that's the point I would emphasize. It's not all 47-year-old truck drivers with Donald Trump stickers on their cars. It's much bigger and scarier and more complex than that.
I think the answer is that we don't know. We don't have enough data to understand whether how much of the current opioid and heroin problem is being driven by liberal prescribing that somehow seeps out of the market of legitimate use into the wider world, or to what extent this is a separate, like the methamphetamine problem, which no one would say has medical origins, because of course that's being manufactured in, you know, the back of cars and in, you know, different kinds of domestic location. So the question that we have to try to answer, I don't think we really know, is how much of the current problem is rooted in the, you might say, the skewing of legitimate prescribing and legitimate use. How much of the deaths are associated with that, and as opposed to a kind of a drug market that has grown up quite apart, in the same way that raves and use of ecstasy, right, grew up apart from a healthcare system. So a lot of the people, like in the recent HHS report that calls for a national pain strategy, calls for more careful analysis of this problem. The other thing I would say historically is that because I looked at sort of Percodan in the past, the irony is that in California in the late 50s, early 60s, there was a heroin problem and a Percodan oxycodone problem existing simultaneously. Although in California, their concern was that heroin addicts were turning towards Percocet as an alternative. Whereas today, we're concerned with quite the opposite, that is with oxycodone people who are addicted to oxycodone turning to heroin. So it highlights how these two phenomena can coexist, and there's no particular logic, but we have to work harder to figure out what the relationship is between them, because the reason why is because, you know, to limit access to OxyContin in order to stem rural opioid abuse, we may be actually harming people who really need OxyContin, right, like that woman in South Carolina, in the name of stemming a problem where we're really not attacking the problem.
Policy is messy. You know, I've watched this since the 1960s, and during that time when Anslinger was still there, and even after his successors came in, there was a cohort of doctors who were so terrified of overprescribing that people were not given drugs when they were in severe pain, even when they were terminal. And it took quite a while to educate a new cohort that could see things in a more reasonable way, who were less terrified about being arrested for prescribing three extra pills. And the old guys never change. And I had direct experience with it with my own family members, where I couldn't convince a family physician to give a father-in-law some relief on the day he was dying because he said, "I don't want him to get addicted."
Yeah.
No, this is serious stuff. Now, the problem is, and the one thing that you might want to plug into your equations, is that when it comes to the legitimate drugs, ultimately, the manufacturer goes through the medical profession, including the dental profession. And so what they do, both the legitimate ones and some of the not so legitimate ones, has a lot to do with how much excess there is and how people are dealt with. Now, there was a third cohort, perhaps unfortunately, because starting in about the 70s, and I know this because I wrote the texts for 25 years, there came a group that said, what's so wrong with leaving people who are not terminal on opiates? As long as they can function and they're comfortable, that's fine. And so somehow that got transmuted into the idea that, you know, very few people get addicted if you give them opiates for pain. The evidence for that was not great. But it caught on anyway, like many things in our world. Just became a headline that nobody dug into. And so there's a cohort now that may still think that very few people get addicted. I don't know how long it will be to retrain them, but it's tough. And so the point is that the other part you have to do is recognize that when you have a product that people put value on, and not just for pain, but opiates have other effects other than pain, some doctors find it tempting to prescribe if people are willing to pay for it. I don't know how many there are, but there were lines around certain doctors' offices in Broward County where there were no coal miners. And the same thing was true in some of the rural areas, and I treated some of those people who were from the rural areas, who were doctors who were giving them opiates. They were alcoholics, but you know, they were doing okay, by the way. It's a complicated business that it's hard to get people to twist the knob just a little bit and to make the adjustments to recognize the woman who needs it from the people who are going to redistribute it.
Dave, just let me, I couldn't agree more with your Delphic utterance. Policy is messy.
And I almost feel guilty having presented at sort of these stages of policy development. There were overlaps like crazy. I mean, there it wasn't just one period of being like following another. But I think you make an excellent point about generations of physicians. Just as there were generations of policy, there were generations of physicians who got set in their ways. And the medical training would change, another generation would come along. So it's almost like there are epicycles on the cycles.
And I just want to add, I think we're kind of wrapping up, but that the pendulum swinging of one generation of physicians recoiling against practices of the previous generation, but themselves swinging so wildly that they produce new problems. I think this is one of the things that we need to address. And one of the problems is, you know, having taught in the medical school at Chapel Hill for 9 years, and pain, education about pain is actually really not well done for medical students. And so they themselves are the victims of the cultural trends in the pendulum swinging. So right now you'll hear them saying pain drugs are bad because of the opioid problem. And then in another time when conservative trends in pain medicine are being pushed back against, they'll say, what's all the problem with, you know, why do we limit access to pain medicine? And so they themselves don't have a kind of a strong and well-developed scientific base upon which to think about what they're doing. And the last thing I'll say is, back in the 1940s, it'll give you a sense of how ingrained anxieties about addiction were back then, that one of the leading edge of end-of-life pain care was surgery, neurosurgery, the lobotomy. And justifying the lobotomy, a Harvard surgeon said, look, this works because it removes the patient's worry center, and they no longer ask for morphine. They still experience pain, they just don't complain about it. So it gives you a sense of how powerful the anxiety about addiction was at the end of life in the 40s, as you're describing, or the 50s, that would be a proper response to end of life pain.
Well, in the 70s for that cohort of physicians.
Right, but now what I'm saying is that now we have a cohort of physicians, as I described in South Carolina at the end of life, who are saying, so bad is the OxyContin problem that we should deny OxyContin to an elderly woman who is dependent on it as she is dying. This is an example of, I think, two kinds of policies that are really gone awry, and that medical education has not served this problem well. So that's my kind of, you know, when I end the book, I say this is one of the things we have to do better.
I'm going to take one last question.
So the medical education piece, the one thing you didn't mention was the role of organized medicine. When there was initial concern about the opioid problem, but Congress gave the FDA additional powers to do something about it. And I was there when they were trying to decide what to do. And one of the issues was, should the education of physicians who were under-educated, should it be mandatory or voluntary? And the AMA very actively, very effectively lobbied against making it voluntary. And there was the Washington Post on Friday had an editorial showing how the number of doctors who have now been educated under that soft approach are much fewer than they expected. And I think that organized medicine is another example of them not doing what would have been useful. The CDC has now come out with some guidelines that may not be attended to by doctors. But maybe you have some things you didn't mention about the role of organized medicine in this, right? But they've been a key non-player, or a player, I think, in the wrong direction.
Yes, another part of the economic story that I never got to, but it's you write about it a bit. You're right, absolutely.
Thank you.
I want to thank our two presenters this morning. Please join me. Thank all of you.